are doing something right. And I, local projects, it's also something that we really recognize, especially during this period when we can't travel, this incredible need in our own backyards, and you guys are stepping up and doing it. It's phenomenal. Great progress on the international projects. It's going to be super exciting to see it get done, and I know Maggie was a big part of that, so really, I know she'll be probably the happiest person to see it done, and we'll hear it here in the office. And then I have to throw out congratulations to the Fundraising, Marketing, and Social Club. None of this would be possible without that work. And it is, the relationships that you're going to find here are what are going to be with you through the rest of your career. You guys are also incredibly fortunate to have a professional chapter right here in your own backyard. And not only that they're right here, but that there's this strong interest and support for your organization. So I applaud. This is what we dream of seeing. All of you coming together like this in an event like this is just incredible. So I just had to say that before I can kick it off here. I'm Jackie O'Brien, and I'm again just thrilled to be here. I was asked to spend a little bit of time to talk about my background and how I got from sitting in that chair to standing up here. So we'll spend a few minutes. As CEO of the organization, I think you guys all know this, but we are 10,000 volunteers strong, which is absolutely incredible. We have opened our fourth country office last year during the global pandemic, so we now have offices in Africa, Central and South America. For me personally, I graduated more than 30 years ago. We'll leave it at that. And since then, I've had a lot of work experience, and I'll spend a few minutes talking through that. I do have my Bachelor of Engineering degree from Ohio State, and I also went back later in my career and got an MBA. And so how did I get from there, from this chair, to where I am today? At Ohio State, I did my co-op with IBM, which was the Facebook and Google back of the day. And I started off in mechanical engineering, but it was a time in the 80s when you were starting to hear a lot about Superfund and what was happening in terms of all of this, you know, heavy industry was taking a toll, right? And we started hearing about Superfund, and we started understanding concerns in the atmosphere, and I got an incredible amount of exposure to that world. Switched my degree to environmental engineering, came back, got my degree, was all excited with my job offer in hand to go work for IBM, and turned out it was a period of recession and the company was going through huge changes. So the job offer got rescinded and I was kind of starting from scratch. So for all of you in a COVID environment where there's challenges, have no fear. I mean, the skills you get are incredibly valuable and those job offers won't come forever. I had, when I grew up, my father worked for a company making tires, and when I was in elementary school, we moved to South America, and I lived there, and we traveled extensively, you know, throughout my school years. So I knew I wanted to do something in international development. I knew I wanted to do something about environmental engineering, and I found that opportunity in the company Alcoa. At that time, it was a much larger company outside of the U.S. than in the U.S., but they were at the kind of forefront of dealing with all of these environmental issues, and they had a CEO who was incredibly committed. I went to work there. I'll say lessons learned. So one thing I did was I always raised my hand, and that's what I see you guys all doing here. You're raising your hand, you're seeing the problem, you're getting involved. I volunteered for a lot, and one of those opportunities was to really kind of look at globally, how do we handle these Superfund areas, how do we address it? And as I got into that work, it was very, very contract management kind of focus. That led to an opportunity where I went into procurement, which was a totally different world, but it was managing a lot of environmental contracts. When I got into that role, one of the things that got recognized was we do work in a lot of different countries that have different standards. So I moved into a role where I was heavily focused on China, Russia, and India. And that, I'll say, that my second lesson was kind of take a risk. At that point, I wasn't necessarily heavy industrial heavy travel, but it was really kind of life-changing to work in different types of environments like that. Given that background of having so much work in developing countries, I got kind of, this is where you get the third lesson, is kind of like ask for help. A business leader was recognizing that there's a business opportunity here, right? The world obviously is getting much more interconnected. And we put together a team of 20 people to study the world. Where's the world going? We engaged with a Boston consulting group, and we did a study called the Global Megatrends. Well, a megatrend is a slow, irreversible movement. These are things that are going to happen that are going to take a long time, but are fundamentally going to change the direction of where the world goes. So we took a team, and we looked at where we were business-wise, and spent a year studying that. And what came out of that was an opportunity to run or to establish green infrastructure and sustainable businesses. And I ended up leading that business, and we looked at renewable energy. We collaborated with solar companies on how to create more efficient products, from concentrated solar to building integrated photovoltaic. We looked at, Maggie heard the story earlier today, but I actually had the experience of sitting in a basement in a hotel in San Francisco, and a company showing up with this crazy idea to build this incredible car where they were going to power it by like 1,000 of these little tiny batteries. And we told them that's impossible. What you're talking about is starting from scratch, a car company, within a few years, from something that's not even really, you know, structurally kind of proven out to work. And that company turned out to be Tesla. So yes, I'm one of those people that, you know, right from the beginning said, well, that will never work. So how well that went over. But we looked at, we ran the business for several years, and it was just absolutely amazing experience. It led to an opportunity where I moved to Spain, worked there for a couple of years. Having grown up in South America, I thought my Spanish was good. I learned to really do business. Business in another language is a whole different level, so I encourage all of you to, if you've taken a language class, keep taking it, because you're at some point in your career, you're going to need it. From there, I moved to New York, worked at our corporate headquarters on Park Avenue, which was a lot of fun to train into at Grand Central every day, and spent a few years working through our company. At that point, decided to do a separation and actually split up into three different companies, and hopefully that. And then I got a call about a company that was based in Seattle in the marine industry, something I'd never worked at before, but as a private owner looking to sell. So I spent some time out in Seattle. During that time, the company I worked for had gotten involved with Engineers Without Borders, and the person who led that relationship was Verma Hall from me. When I heard about it, all I could say is, why didn't they have this when I was in school? This was phenomenal. Said, I want to get involved, came home, told my husband about it, my husband said, I want to get involved, and he ended up going to Dominica, working there for several weeks on a project, and that's kind of when we knew we were hooked. I went to the annual conference, ended up getting on the board of directors, and absolutely loved the organization. Last year, during the pandemic, as I was board president-elect, the CEO was stepping down to retire. We had gone through an extensive search process for a year and a half, ended up not resulting in a candidate, and I stepped in to run the organization. And it's been quite a ride over the last 18 months. If anyone who joined the town hall last week, I think you heard a great story. You know, we've done a lot over the last year. We've got more to do, but we're strong. We survived the pandemic, and we've got a good plan going forward. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. That's, in a nutshell, how I got from there to here. All right, so what we want to really talk about, the Engineers Without Borders. So I'm not sure how many people know this, but 2022 will be the 20th anniversary. Super exciting, amazing, that 20 years ago, it was Dr. Bernard Amadei with 12 students going on a trip talk or hear from Dr. Amadei? I've got one. Okay, awesome, awesome person. I talked to him regularly, talked to him last week. He is incredibly passionate, still involved. I would welcome you if you ever see an opportunity to listen to him speak, join it. If you attend a conference and he's there, walk up and introduce yourself. He loves this organization. He loves all the volunteers, and we'd be thrilled to talk with you. So since then, where are we now? I mentioned the 10,000 volunteers, 38 countries. What I'm really happy to see too now is in over 28 states and territories, which is phenomenal, addressing the need right here. It's almost 500 projects, active projects underway, and when you count up, you know, what's the impact of that? It's over 1.4 million people. So we have 240 chapters. That's quite phenomenal. 165 student chapters, and as we hear about today, the students graduate, right, and they want to keep going. So we now have 75 professional chapters. We just did the study, and the big surprise for me is about half of the volunteers are students and half are professionals. So I think that is, you know, an incredible testament to this experience you're having here today. You have the opportunity to carry forward, and it continues to grow in that direction. We have 45% of our volunteers are women. We ran a, we participated in a National Science Foundation study a few years ago, and the question was why. I don't know if anyone has heard of the movie Picture Scientist. It's on Netflix. I strongly encourage everyone in this room to watch it. And what our organization does, what came out of that National Science Foundation study was the ability to listen and to empathize with people is what makes this kind of a safe space for people to join. And if you watch that movie, that is what's needed to really change the industry, change the world. It's not, we need to do more. We started an intersectionality committee. We need to start doing metrics and understand, really, as an organization, how are we inclusive to everybody. But this is an incredible step in the right direction. And we talked about four country offices, and we're up to about 10% of our projects being based in the U.S. So that's just within 5 years, which is a great step forward. Okay, next. So, where do we go from here? Last year, in 2020, we ran a 5-year strategic plan, which I hope everyone's had a chance if you joined the annual conference. We talked about the three pathways. It's going deeper, right? That's why we have country offices. We don't want to just go broad, we want to go deep. It's about human capacity. We have 10,000 volunteers. We also have millions of people in country that we impact, and we want to create pathways for everybody to develop their full human capacity. So we're focused on that. And third is about resilience. We all know what the world's been over the last year and a half, and we incorporated that thinking into our strategic plan. That third bullet of resilience is what is playing out in our 2022 budget. There was a town hall last week we've had to reflect that in our 2022 budget. We've cut HQ staff by 50%. We've taken a lot of actions we may not have wanted to take in a normal time. But if you go back to our strategic plan and our core value and resiliency, we have to be here. We have to deliver to all of these people, all of these communities that we've made commitments to. And the way we do that is we had to make some really, really tough choices. So just like you guys are doing, you fundraise, you raise money, and that says what you can do. We're doing the same at HQ. And I'm happy to answer more questions about that. CEO search. So I'm, you guys may have heard, we are undergoing a CEO search. When I stepped into the role, like I mentioned, I was on the board, president-elect, running the search committee. We found a great candidate that didn't work out. The executive directors stepped down. I had been, the company I worked for, we'd actually sold within 2 years when it was a 5-year plan. It was the perfect time to step in and help the organization through a really, really challenging time. What has become obvious over the last year and a half, as we've done the strategic plan, is we're going to have to evolve for our next 20 years. We're in a great place right now. We've survived the pandemic. When I stepped into the role, a lot of change had happened. And if you talk to people on the professional chapter, they will tell you there has been so much change. In 2020, we eliminated all membership dues, we eliminated all project fees, we put in cost share, and the organization paid out over $1 million in cost share. We went from one country office to 4 country offices in a very short time, we doubled staff. There was a lot of change in a very, very short period. And what I wanted to do is really step in, set the organization on a strong path for the next long-term leader to step in. So we've worked on identifying and developing some really, really strong candidates. We are doing a comprehensive search. I'm 100% committed to staying on until the new person is in place. And I will continue to stay involved in supporting the new leader. That's the path we're on right now. So don't have a timeline. We're going to do this and we're going to do it right. And we have the fortune of having time. And we have the fortune of being in a solid financial place now after going through a really tough almost 2 years. So another thing I'm really excited about and committed to is when we did the strategic plan, the first thing typically when you update a strategic plan is you look at your mission and your vision. And you kind of pressure test it, is this the right thing? We started that when we kicked off the strategic planning process. We are very unique because we have a dual mission, right? And that's growing global leaders, which is you are all part of. And it's also empowering communities to meet their basic human needs. Now, we recognize there's some wording that needs to be updated, right? So we spent a little bit of time doing that. However, there's so much passion and commitment. We didn't want to rush this. We really wanted to do it right. So we paused on the mission. We're coming back to it now. But I can say without a doubt, it is all about that dual mission. If we were only about, you know, serving communities, there might be more efficient ways to do it. If we were only about growing global leaders, we might do things differently. But where this organization, where the strength lies and the uniqueness of this organization is that we can do both. And when we do both and we do it right, we create more value for everybody. And this organization was founded on partnerships, and that's, again, the really unique part of what we do are these partnerships. So 100% the dual mission continues and is absolutely foundational for the future, the next 20 years of this organization. And you guys are an incredible part of that. And why are we doing this? Why am I out here? Why are we doing this now? Well, we've got the organization stabilized. Financials are in a good place. But now what we need to do is really kind of get the organization back on its feet. A lot of people took hits last year, right? Students weren't on campus. Professional chapters were doing, you know, they were on Zoom all day with work, and then they're trying to call in at night. You're not traveling. All of that is starting to come back. Obviously, we're all in a room together. Professional chapters are getting things back in place. We're starting that's kind of love bar, but she is awesome. So thank you so much for taking the time, driving down here, coming to this, and you know, talking to all these students. Like, I know as like a chapter member originally and a volunteer originally, sometimes it feels like your work is going unnoticed. So I know I've made it a priority to acknowledge the people who do everything that we want to accomplish with the organization. And Jackie also wants to do that for you guys. So, I mean, that's why we take the time out of our day and we prioritize this. Because at the end of the day, like, we would not have a successful mission without the volunteers that are by our side. So we're here to support you guys. I don't know if it was super, I mean, it's been super clear, but I think that's why we're trying to spell it out right now. Like, the only reason we're here as HQ is just to help these chapters and these communities meet these basic needs. And Jackie's done a great job of trying to manage that. Still got work to do and still got to improve, but I think that's kind of the whole circle of everything we've done as an organization and how we strive to constantly be better at what we're doing. So some of you guys may know me and some of you guys may know my story, so sorry you're hearing it again. But I was the 2019-2020 EWB OSU president. I kind of forced my way in there and I was honestly not super involved my junior year. So I'm lucky that some people were like, oh heck, you could just do it. Because no one was really like, people were not as involved as you guys are today. And I think it's so awesome to see that now. The amount of growth in this community has been tremendous. And I think that's a huge attribution to like the community that you guys have developed here. I just say that like for me, it was like the part that made it so difficult to leave Ohio State, especially so abruptly as I did during COVID. Leaving people behind and not really getting to say goodbye. It's probably why I've kind of lingered around so long. People really can't get rid of me here, so keep coming up. So I was an engineering major. I was industrial and systems engineering. Fun fact, I did not want to do engineering before this. I was just like, what's kind of hard? I'll just try it, see if it will make me successful. So I, and that's kind of a lot of my stuff is that I think I just like to do things the hard way. Some of the officers who worked with me maybe found that to be kind of annoying, but I think the organization was better because of it, and then they also kind of were like, all right, Maggie's a little intense. We're gonna chill it out. It's gonna be fine. So I did try pretty much everything under the sun in college. I would not encourage that for everyone because I literally never slept, and I did a lot of stuff. But that's how I like to do things. I did two minors. I kind of took a bunch of classes outside of engineering. I failed at a lot of it. Like, I was not good at it. I tried three majors in engineering. I did a few clubs here and there. Tried research, tried everything. But I would like to encourage that story. Like, well, maybe the way I did it was a little crazy. Try something, you know, go out there. I mean, this is the time to try things and fail. And I think they made it, I think those experiences made me better and kind of made me willing to try things and go outside of my comfort zone. And I think also, again, it made me resilient as a person. When I was graduating, I kind of didn't really have a thorough thought process on what I wanted to be, what I wanted to do. Honestly, I was really lost because I felt no passion towards making a lot of money and being an engineer, which I think was the reason why I got into engineering in the first place. So I applied to the Peace Corps, and I was like, you know what, I'll just go away, maybe that'll help. And unfortunately, that was not in the plan, because I was going to leave in September of 2020, and obviously, that was in the middle of the global pandemic. So I kept waiting for that time to send, like, to go to Peru. I was really excited, but I just kept waiting and waiting and waiting until they were kind of like, yeah, you'll have to reapply. So, but honestly, that has been the biggest blessing in disguise because I would not become the executive fellow at Ohio State or at EWB without that. I mean, I just saw this posting online and I was like, you know what, I'll apply. I applied late. I almost missed my interview, and I'm lucky that they still saw something in me, and I'm really excited to kind of be working under this and kind of transitioning our organization as a whole. I think it's been really awesome to have my hand in that and also give honest and open feedback to Jackie and all of the staff. They've been extremely receptive of a volunteer experience. I also didn't, in between those times, I didn't talk about this, but I did work at seasonal jobs in Martha's Vineyard and Vail as a ski bum. It's been a great decision to kind of take a break from engineering. So again, I advocate try something new, get away for a little bit. Don't feel the pressure to just start right away, because I mean, again, if I hadn't taken those breaks, I would not be ending up in the dream job that I am right now. So that's my biggest advice. And then I'd also like to thank Lily for requiring me to speak at this, because she's been such a big support. I think all of the people that I've met through this organization have been really important. They're really awesome, and really appreciate those memories and stuff you guys have here, because you know there could be another global pandemic and then you're just gone. So that's what happened to me. I'm going to talk briefly about this because this is something that a lot of people talk to me and ask me, well, how did you get this job? And I totally get it, because as a chapter member, as a chapter officer, as a volunteer, I was like, well, how can I make this full-time? Because I was doing it all the time after school. The biggest thing, I mean, that you guys can do, obviously, is join this chapter. And that's what a lot of you guys have done, and that should be recognized, because that's awesome. You're already doing the first step of kind of doing this work, and that's really important. So don't feel like you're not doing anything. Apply for a volunteer opportunity. These are on our Volunteer Village access. There's a ton of them right now. I think that's something that's to be said with the pandemic. It's been kind of challenging to get more involvement as a broader sense, but we need that input from chapter leaders and chapter members on a larger scale and with the regions and HQ. So don't kind of like ignore those opportunities, because sometimes it can be really important in developing like everything for the greater chapter base. And your chapter is so amazing, it should be recognized by other chapters who are maybe struggling a little bit more than you guys. But to get into the good stuff that maybe some of you guys are interested in, we do offer internships. I will say, and this is also something that I knew as a chapter member, our opportunities are limited. We don't really advocate a ton of the opportunities for paid internships and fellowships, because we only have like three right now, so maybe two. And I'm one of one. So, I mean, it is limited, and there's a reason for that, and that is because we don't run a ton of overhead. We really try and limit our expenses, and that's so that everything else can go to you guys and go to supporting the chapters and the volunteers. We obviously want to help you guys, and we think that, you know, getting volunteers engaged at like internship and fellowship levels is important, which is why I have the role I do. But again, they're just limited just because of the amount of funds that we have. But again, that's an email, and I will be sure to advertise opportunities to the chapter members as they become available. As I am biased, and I think you guys are the best. So, and then I will also stay in contact, but this is something that I could give advice to some of my younger members or my soon-to-be graduates. Stay in contact. It is something that I was told so much in college, is to stay in contact with the mentors, the peers that you have long-term, and develop those relationships, especially when you get out of college. I'm still involved with some of my mentors, and pretty much, like, I just kind of wish I had more of them. So I know everyone says it probably in college, but talk to your professors, because if you have one, even just one, they give the greatest advice. And I have some incredible women mentors that I get to look up to. But also, I am here, and I'm happy to hear from you guys. I literally answer emails all the time, and that's pretty much most of my job. But I also would like to advertise opportunities to you guys, but you guys reaching out makes it a lot easier for me to remember them. So definitely don't be afraid to. And then, as we've already talked about, joining professional chapters after college is a huge way to keep involvement. It's something that we haven't really advertised as a chapter as much, but as you guys start to move to that progression of becoming professionals in the outside world, you guys can still make a difference with this incredible work that I know you guys care about so much. say that you can also be a mentor for these communities, like these student chapters that you've been a part of, and you can help develop the next generation of us. And I think that's been something that's really near and dear to my heart, something super important, which is why I still come here and try and talk to you guys.